Check 1, 2, 2, 2. How's everybody doing out there? Y'all good? Everybody good? This mic is real hot. Real hot. All right, so we're going to get started in just a few moments. I'm going to see if I can corral everybody in here. Hey, Angel, how you doing? You good? Good evening, everybody. How's everybody doing out there? Y'all good? Make some noise if you're alive and breathing in there. I said make some noise if you're alive and breathing in there. Some of y'all are obviously making no noise. Some of y'all are concerned. All right. So I hope you're glad you're here for this lively discussion this evening. It's a pleasure and an honor to have both of these folks in the house. They are family, part of the Hayti family. Miss Lana Garland. Y'all show you all the Lana. And Dance Theatre of Harlem's new artistic director, Mr. Robert Garland. Y'all show you all the Lana. And if you didn't know, Dance Theatre is in the building. Dance Theatre of Harlem will be at Caroline Theatre, thank you, on Thursday. So y'all make sure y'all go and check them out. But before we get into all the logistics and everything, y'all welcome to Hayti. And I found no better person than to welcome you to Hayti than our executive director. Y'all show your love for Miss Angela Lee.
Special place. So we honor family, and tonight we honor the Garland family. We belong to the part of the Hayti family. And Robert, tonight you are officially a member of that same Hayti family. We honor you both, and we welcome you all.
I'll show you love for Angela one more time. And before we get into things even further, we have a performance the other night, and I saw this young lady dance, and I was like, yo, what are you doing on Tuesday? You need to be here. She was just such a phenomenal dancer, and she is a student at Central, right down the street. Eagle Pride. And I was like, yo, I saw her dance, and I was like, hopefully we'll see her at a Dance Theatre of Harlem or American Ballet or Alpha Amy very, very in the near future when she graduates. So y'all show your love, start clapping right now for J.Y.A. Go ahead.
Son fui déjà oublié le temps.
show you love DJ one more time. She hails from New York City. So tonight, we're going to introduce brother and sister, artistic siblings. I'm going to do the official spiel, their official bios that they gave me. Right? So about Lana Garland. Lana's award-winning work as a creative director, producer, writer, director, and educator in television and film can be seen in the U.S., Europe, and Africa. Her content has aired on HBO, BET, PBS, and ESPN in America, and TV2 in Denmark. In documentary, Lana has worked with films such as Bowie for Columbine, HBO's Unchained Memories, Readings from the Slave Narratives, and recently a film about the disappearance of black funeral homes called The Passing On. Yeah. Yes, which is a very good film. And most importantly, she is the festival director and curator of the Hayti Heritage Film Festival. And she's also a Fulbright specialist in film at Makerere University in Uganda, and is a member of the North Carolina Governor's Advisory Council on Film, Television, and Digital Streaming. Y'all show your love for Lana. Now about Mr. Robert Garland. Robert Garland was a member of the Dance Theatre of Harlem Company, achieving the rank of principal dancer. After creating a work for the DTH School Ensemble, Arthur Mitchell invited Robert to create a work for the Dance Theatre of Harlem Company and appointed him the organization's first resident choreographer. He was also director of a professional training program of DTH School and the organization's webmaster. In addition to choreographing several ballets for DTH, Mr. Garland has also created works for New York City Ballet, Britain's Royal Ballet, Oakland Ballet, and many others. His commercial work has included music, videos, commercials, and short films, including the children's television show Sesame Street, a Nike commercial featuring New York Yankee Derek Jeter, the NAACP Image Awards, a short film for designer Donna Karen, and the Sherman Cha-Cha for Procter & Gamble. Mr. Garland holds a Bachelor of Fine Arts degree from the Juilliard School in New York City, and Mr. Garland is currently the director of Harlem Schools. He is the director of Dance Theatre Harlem School Director as well, but he just got newly appointed as artistic director. So y'all show your love for that, show your love. So we're gonna call up the two stage siblings, artistic family. Y'all show your love for Lana Garland and Mr. Robert Garland.
Hayti, this particular structure has been around since I'd say the mid-1800s, this church was built. And so this comprised the cornerstone of the Hayti, what was the Hayti community. And the Hayti community was also known as Black Wall Street. And the history of that, and it's important that we say this, just as, you know, Angela kind of acknowledged the indigenous land that we stand upon, it's also important to talk about the Hayti community and its positioning in Black America, the fact that this is the area that Black people flourished, you know, just after slavery. And it's the area whereby we were able to kind of build homes and take care of each other. And that continued up until the 1960s when they put a highway through the community, thus decimating the neighborhood, as always, and killing the businesses. And the reason why I feel like it's important to state this at every gathering that we have at Hayti nowadays is because we're under attack. And so currently there's a fight for the last remaining land that used to be Hayti. It's always real estate. If we talk about Central Park and how that was a Black neighborhood, if we talk about Wall Street and how that was a Black neighborhood, here we are again. And so, if you want
to... that's exactly why the New Declaration of Independence was originally life, liberty, and the pursuit of property. Mm-hmm. And then it was changed to the pursuit of happiness.
Mm-hmm. So, yes. All right, you better drop that knowledge before. You know.
That's how we go.
I'm going to have to bring my A game. I'm going to have to sit up straight. So it's not just about the pretty face, that's right. If you want to know more about that fight, go to Hayti Reborn. Check out what's happening with Hayti Reborn, because we could use soldiers in the fight. So that being said, I just want to ground a little bit and bring in the ancestors. I want to acknowledge those who have trodden upon these lands. And I also want to ground and bring into the space the people who have made it possible that my brother and I are here. So I call the name of Robert Garland Sr., I call the name of Mildred Garland, I call the name of Bessie Eugenia Scott Garland, I call the name of the gun, William Garland. And so if you want to just take a moment to call into the space your ancestor to help us have a conversation that's not only rooted in family, art, and creativity, but you got a little bit of say in this too, because we're in community together. So on the count of three, I want you to call the ancestor that you're bringing to the community. One, two, three. Thank you. I also have to quickly acknowledge, I just have to acknowledge the fact that we have to, it would be remiss of me to not respect the royalty that is in the room today by way of Virginia Johnson. Virginia, thank you for being who you are. Thank you for being a loyal steward to the ship that has been the Dance Theatre of Harlem. Thank you for your time, and thank you for your service in the expression of the arts of the African American. Thank you.
Yeah.
And I'd like you to also just acknowledge the two lovely DTH dancers who are in attendance.
Christopher Charlie Daniels in the back. Who started dancing and Miss Daphne Lee, whose mother was a ETH alumni, and now she's a company member as well.
Thank you for being here. Okay.
Well, we should add your husband.
Okay. Would you like to?
Yeah, well, when we lived in New York, we went around some all together. And he was in school at the time. I think he graduated by now. And by that time, and so Dance Theatre of Harlem desperately needed an IT person. And so he was right there, and I was like, we need an IT person. So I actually, and he did work for Arthur Mitchell as well, as the IT guy. So thank you, Kai.
Yes. Okay. So I'm going to take us on a journey. So we have some time, as I understand it, to talk together. And I think what will be probably be most useful is to talk about, you know, our how we get to be in conversation today. And so, beginning from that place, I have to acknowledge my sister, who has known us since I was 7 or 8, you 8 or 9, my sister Holly Rule Lewis, yeah. She's like, you know, how many people here have known me since the age of 8? Because we grew up in this very, now that I know, it's a charmed community.
It was the most diverse community in America.
Right.
In the 70s. Yeah.
And we didn't know that. And it's still like that to this day. But what I didn't know that the Quakers designed it to be that way.
Yes, yes.
And so in our community, in the neighborhood of Mount Airy, there were white, black, Jewish, Chinese, Puerto Rican, you know, poor, rich, middle class, it was everybody, and we all kind of coexisted. We went to the same schools. You really didn't hear too much about people going to private schools back
not
then?
Not at all. We would go to public school.
Right.
And I don't know all of
it. Yeah. So, you know, when you think about it now, it's like, oh my God, people are so segregated now. And that just wasn't our experience. And so,
and that school was about a mile and a half away, or a mile?
It was a mile. Because I remember at 7th Avenue was the cutoff for the mile. And I remember that because we could not ride the bus to school because 7th Avenue was the cutoff, and we were just under 7th Avenue. Yeah.
And that's why we walked the roads to school.
And that's why we walked through the snow. So, I remember, I'm gonna pull one memory of walking to Houston Elementary School. And so whenever there were rainy days at Houston or in Philadelphia, Houston would bring us into the auditorium, play, put on some music, and we would dance on stage, right? So usually there were mainly girls dancing on stage, and the only boy who had the courage to dance on stage was my brother.
I do, yes.
And you became that guy. Yes. So, you know, how was it, and just to give you the family dynamic, we're 1 year apart. He's a year older than me, and we have a sister who's 2 years younger than me. And so, you know, for me, I'm a middle child, so of course I'm sitting in the audience like, I can do that. I can be up on the stage, but nobody asked me to be up on the stage. Right? So, my question for you is, how did that feel being kind of like, not only just at school, kind of like that it was almost like a star even back then, but also in the family with, dad had what, 12, 14 brothers, 14, 16, 18, yeah. 20 brothers, yeah. Yeah. And so he was the first son out of 30 granddaughters. So there were 30 granddaughters and then him. So you can imagine why he was a star in the family, right? So I want to know what your experience of that was.
Well, you know, one thing about that space, that theater, in that public school, was that it was also where the music classes happened. So I played organ there, and eventually played the violin there also. So there was a level of comfortability I had in that space as well. That's where all the kids that wanted to do that. So I don't know, I think everyone had to choose an instrument, or did you have to choose?
Yeah, I did piano.
Oh, okay, all right. Well, I did the organ and the violin, mm-hmm. and it happened in that space. And so there was a level of comfortability already built in.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that that was part of the trajectory towards art.
Yeah.
Of course, our family dynamic also.
Okay.
Family dynamic,
oh my God.
Which were our performers as well. I mean, not professionally, but they perform.
Okay, so we're talking about the Garlands. The Garlands, you know, anytime we got together, there was a house party. So, you know, it's funny because my friend Courtney Reed Eaton says that I start the parties here, like I'm a party starter. And the reason why I am is because my family members who usually do that aren't here.
Right.
They're not here. And so who's going to do it? So it's so funny. It reminds me of like when Babyface talks about how, you know, that, you know, he's gotten all these awards and all this recognition. But if you talk to him, he will say, there are people who are much talented than I. In the family, and I just happened to be the one who was kind of I made it through.
Yeah,
and I'm wondering if you have any type of, how do you feel about that? Do you feel as though there were, if I think back, there wasn't anybody else doing? Oh well, actually, Debbie Mannin.
Yeah, Debbie Mannin.
Okay, so if you want to set the stage for, you know, the other or your transition from dancing at Houston on rainy days to some sort of professional dancing?
Okay, so I started dancing late when I was 13, which for women is late, for boys it's not, which is a little problematic, but we're trying to fix that. And so I was dancing my first year of high school, and so I was traveling back and forth to Performing Arts High School. And then in the evening, I was dancing at a place called Pennsylvania Ballet for a bit, which is the local ballet company. And then Philadelphia Dance Company. And then when I was taken into Philadelphia Dance Company, it was when I began to start to...
Otherwise known as Philadelphia?
That's when I began to see it as a real profession. But One of my favorite stories is I went to rehearsal one day and got home, and I was like, Mom, there's this girl there, she's really good. You know, her name is Deborah Mann. My mother was like, oh, that's your cousin. And I was like, my cousin? She's like, yeah, that's your cousin. And so she actually went on to have a really, really important career at the Abilene American Dance Theater. It was her that Alvin chose to film Judy Jamison's solo Cry in Posterity, and
you can see it on YouTube.
You can see it on YouTube. Brilliant dancer, along with several other people. So Philadelphia Dance Company. I was very, very young, about 15, and the rest of them were in their early 20s. So I was kind of like a little kid for them. So being in that space, that moved into New York, where I was a kid still, but at Juilliard, and they would run a chance in the Bay Area. About, I would say, 8 to 10. And moving to Italy.
Let me tell you something. Yes, because y'all not you, but they were gods to me. You were my brother. You know, they were, because you were the baby of the bunch, but we had in the people who took him in, first at Philadelphia and then in New York when he was at Juilliard, were people who had left the Philadelphia company and went on to dance with Al Nally. The two Debbies, Debbie Chase and Debbie Manning, you know, Gary DeLoach, legendary dancers, Kevin, and you know, the experience, so I'm a year younger, and the experience of my going to Gary DeLoach's apartment in New York City off of Central Park West, and I'm in high school, right? We go in there. Bobby's like beating some pots, cooking some meal for everybody. And The dancers are in a space that's probably about as big as this rug, performing Revelations. And so
they dance always.
I'm hoping, I'm like, oh my God. And so
well, Virginia knows that building as well, because on the floor above there were Dance in the Park. Was it Dance in the Park? Yes, yes.
Is that right? Yes. And nobody told me? Mm-hmm.
A guy by the name of Roman Brooks, who also went to Yale as well. I had an apartment there, along with Stan Perry and several other people. So when I first met Virginia, she was actually doing a hustle in someone's living room. with her partner of the moment, probably not even the moment, I don't know. Yeah. Wow.
So what's happening for me at that time, at the same time, so early on, I was, because of him, you know, I wanted to learn how to read when he learned how to read. I wanted to do everything that he did, and what that did, it made me a really good student. And so I became branded as the smart one, which was kind of boring, but it's like, okay, I got my lane, I guess. I'll be the smart one. And so, you know, took a engineering lane, and I was a big and still am a science geek, until I went to a co-op. So I went to Drexel University, and they have a co-op program. And the co-op program is such that you go to school for 6 months, and then you do an internship for 6 months. One of my internships was, it was right after the Tylenol scare. Do you remember that? Yeah. Remember when people died from taking Tylenol? Well, I was there right after that. And so I'm there, a junior engineer at 19 years old, and I'm hearing conversations like, oh, well, you know, you have to wear makeup because you're not pretty enough. And don't wear red lipstick because your lips are big. And, you know, you're not wearing an appropriate bra or suit. See my little boobies. Every day, there was some type of attack. And I said to myself, well, corporate America isn't for me. So I've got to find something else to do. And so I went back to school for business, got my business degree at University of Maryland, and I'm working at Bloomingdale's as a productivity manager. And at some point I was like, I've got to go to grad school. This isn't doing anything for me. And I see this thing that says, oh, well, you can become a manager at media corporations through this program at Syracuse University. So long story short, I ended up getting my master's at Syracuse. Then from Syracuse, I moved to New York City with all my stuff.
Yes.
I was in his apartment, just bags everywhere.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I got a job at HBO, and that was the beginning of my career in TV and media. But let me just back up a little bit and say,
you were the first person that had a computer in our
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I was the first one?
Yes, maybe speak and teach us typing. You don't know that program?
No.
Yeah, that was a typing program.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right.
Yeah, you brought that with you as well.
Okay. Well,
I think we want to know, you know, it was interesting because, like, I had kind of found myself in a space where I was sort of coddled by people that were culturally alike, meaning black people. And Lana, at an early age, had moved into another environment that I had no clue of at all. And that's what was fascinating about the time. I was like, there are people like that? It was amazing to me that you lived as a high school student.
Oh, you mean like people in STEM?
In the McNeil situation, which we were talking about.
Oh, yeah.
Very, very crazy to me.
Right.
You had experienced that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. And I was just so devastated. And mom didn't even know about that until 2 years ago. Mom said to me 2 years ago, you know, why did you leave engineering? And then I told her that story, and she was crestfallen. She was like, I didn't know. I didn't know what to do with that information. Somebody telling you, you're not good enough. And I believed it. I believed it to the extent where that I didn't tell anybody. I just dropped out of school. And people were like, oh, well, you know, Lana just dropped out of school. You know, but I was devastated. But then when I went to Syracuse, you know, I'm taking these courses in this media management, and I already had it. I had a degree in business, so I didn't need, you know, accounting and marketing. I had already done that. So I started taking production classes. And so I'm going to pivot now to show you, and I don't show this. I don't show this. So if y'all say that I showed this film, I'm saying you're not. I've never made a film called A Song for You that stars my brother. So this is my first film in grad school. And it's messy. It's 16 millimeter. But I love it because it is what it is. And my brother's in it. Yeah. So I think we're going to take, without further ado, we're going to show a song for you.
and Comden Avenue, and right next to the police precinct, which eventually, the 30th precinct, which eventually got the name of the Dirty 30,
right.
Because there had been a body thrown off the top of the roof.
That roof?
Yeah, that roof.
Wow.
And we saw it. I remember that happening. It was the most amazing moment through my young adult life. But the other interesting thing, though, on the lighting room, is that across the hall, Ty Jimenez lived there.
Oh, the amazing Ty Jimenez.
Yes.
Yes, another principal dancer of the Dance Theatre of Harlem, and soon to be
director of the Dance of Harlem School when I stepped into the artistic director position. She's a brilliant, brilliant dancer. Is there a question?
Yeah, or can we say a question? I know we can ask them as you're.
Can't hear you.
Can we ask the questions now, or do we hold them for like?
You can. You're going to have to stand up and project.
My question is, like, during that time period where it's, like, would I say, like, it's hard to be creative, especially as a black man, how was that for you? Like, living through that time period when you weren't being creative, dancing, and, like, you know, there's still stereotypes that you will face as a black man. How was that like for you?
You know, it's funny because we also, Lana's moving to New York from Syracuse was one thing, but it was also the advent of music that we actually brought with us from Philadelphia, the hip hop era. You know, and so it had its drawbacks, definitely in terms of community, but there was also a privacy to the community that was really beautiful. Like, there wasn't such a thing as black women. Which doesn't really exist anymore.
Right.
You know, it just does not exist. You know, so that local information was passed differently. So you found out about things in another kind of way. So there was very little proximity between us and, say, someone that had so-called or was accomplishing big things like a Puffy or a, you know, I don't know, Al Sharpton.
Right. It was always somebody's cousin, someone, you know,
it was different.
It was a different time, and that's how we used to roll, because, you know, it wasn't the, although with the advent of hip-hop, it became about, you know, kind of aspiring to something that was more elite as hip-hop evolved. But when our generation, you know, were the progenitors of that, but it was very much about, it started as community, and it was all about community, and so, you know.
The filmmaking, well, Lana brought me into the filmmaking community, actually, which is its own thing.
Right. So, I hope that answers a part of the question, but it was another time. And so, we are members of what they call Generation Jones. I don't like that because Generation Jones is supposed to kind of elicit the idea and notion that we were Jonesing to be something. So if you think about Wall Street, when that movie came out with Michael Douglas, it was like, it was the Reagan era and trying to, you know,
that's a big one. Yeah.
Yes, yes. So trading and arbitrage and all of those things kind of came to but for, and so they're calling it us Generation Jones. But for black people, it was generation proof that the legislation that was created during the civil rights era is going to stand and it's going to mean something. So we were the guinea pigs for everything that happened during the civil rights generation. And so that meant that, you know, they thrust us in these programs where, oh, you should be an engineer and you can be a whatever. But the society was not prepared. And we went in there, and so that's why I'm in this area in STEM that's not prepared for a person like me. And so black people are going to create. We've always done that as a response to trauma. And so it's not a conversation. If you look at kind of our two careers, he was able to thrive in POC communities post-Juilliard. So after Juilliard, he went to Bella Hispanica and ultimately the Dance Theatre of Harlem. I didn't have that. And I to this day regret the fact that I didn't go to an HBCU, because that could have helped me in a way that I really needed it for that time.
Yes. That's a thing. It's starting to become even more of a thing, actually.
Right. Yes.
But the beauty, I would say, of being a part of the organization I'm a part of is that it is an HBCU. Mm-hmm. There's a dancer, Hood Parker, who was a dancer with Dance Theatre of Harlem, eventually went to ALA, and now she's on the faculty at North Carolina School of the Arts, where England is. You know, and she's saying that, she said, you know, I didn't need actually an HBCU, because my fraternity, my sorority, the people I danced with, you know, and so, and that's not unusual for people. My friend Monica talks about this. People of color, black people, you know, we've always created our own social lanes, quote unquote. This is one right here that we're in. You know, there are four kind of major black modern dance companies: Philadelphia Dance Company, Dallas Black Dance Theater, Washington Dance Theater, and Dayton Contemporary Dance Theater. All of them are founded in churches all across the world. It's not unusual for me that we are in an artistic space that is, again, a church. The church is always a much larger place, which I wish young people would get to understand. That it's not just about coming in. It is about worship. But the main thing is about gathering. It's about gathering. Share. There's another.
Okay. Can you hold that for just a moment? I want to pivot to kind of one of your clips. So what would you say would be a nice transition to in terms of one of your choreographic clips?
I think it could be choreographic.
Whatever you want.
Or, you know, I think I would like to show, it's 3 minutes. Is that okay?
Yeah.
But I think I'm going to show the Andre Leon Talley one.
Because, well, you know he's from here.
Yes. There's that.
Right.
You know, and so I did a ballet called Return to the Music of Aretha Franklin and James Brown. And so it became a bit of a test, both for our ballet audiences and for the black people that were inside of the ballet environment, because sometimes people, you know, black folks get funny about blackness as well.
Yeah.
It's a whole other conversation.
Right.
You know. And so I've done that, and so the commentary was that the ballet would not have been as successful had it not been for the music. And my point was, there's a vernacular to black movement that when placed anywhere, it uplifts. So the next thing I did was a bop by a rhythm chair, though, kind of employing the same idea. And so this interview with Andre Leon Talley is about that ballet and bop. And he says some very interesting things in that very colorful way that he has. And this is a very long, and the reason I like this too, because Mr. Mitchell's in it as well. Mm-hmm. And there was nothing better than having Mr. Mitchell, who's very, very, you know, buttoned down, conservative, and Andre Leon Talley. Okay, so let's watch.
This week, vote staff actor Andre Leon Talley took the advice of our country's leaders and went out on the town. He headed to Harlem to visit Arthur Mitchell, founder and artistic director of the Dance Theatre of Harlem, an American cultural institution that continues to thrive.
Just seeing something beautiful, a performance, can actually restore hope, and ballet and dance can do that, don't you think? The arts ignite the mind. They give you the possibility to dream and to hope. They also act as a healing model.
Yes.
Harlem is a magic word. Mm-hmm. No matter where you go around the world, everybody wants to come here. Mm-hmm. And if you look back historically, someone from every race, class, creed, or color at one time has lived here in Harlem. Yes. Yeah! Tell us about how you found the company. The ironic thing is that Dance Theater was born out of a tragedy. tragedy of Dr. Martin Luther King, and I felt it was very important to come back to this community of Harlem and do something positive. What do you look for in a dancer who has not had any training?
Okay.
And how do they become a member of the school?
Okay.
We have auditions. And we started at 3 years old in the school. I look at it and I say, I think that child has something, or that child has something.
So it'd be sometimes something just like a sparkle in the eye as opposed to sparkle in the feet. That's all.
Yeah. You can tell right with 5 kids who are coming here now, and I say move, you'll see one that everything is right. All they need is the education and the technique. Then there are some who may not have the physical attributes. They've got that thing. Dance Theatre, basically, because it's a small company, all of the dancers have to have that.
As a black dancer, you have to study everything. You have to prepare for anything. So ballet, modern jazz, tap, flamenco, you do everything.
Tell me, what is Robert's thought?
Mr. Mitchell was very good in saying that, you know, Robert, it's really important that you understand that Bob is cutting edge in his company. And being that he's cutting edge, you have to approach it in a cutting edge way.
Bach is one of the forefathers of jazz.
I know. It's
great. And so that rhythm and that pulse, and you put that little thing in. See, and that's what we as African Americans always bring to the arts.
Yes.
We keep stretching.
Yes.
And that's what makes it classic in America. Because taking the classics, but extending the vocabulary.
But it was never you cross over the Hoochie Mama.
Right.
How do you distinguish, how do you keep that fine line from being crossed over?
The classical element, the classical ballet already gives you a certain stature.
Yeah.
You know, so once you combine that with natural moves, it creates something that's very unique. Dance is the only real communal art form. Through this great tragedy that we are still in this, the dancers, we're kind of concerned about still having the season. But I told them, this is the time in the world you should know as an artist.
Right.
You know, they need to be able to escape for a minute.
The thoughts and prayers of everyone at your front.
It's so interesting to me because as an educator, I have taught a lot of the stories that you've shared with me. You know, and I think anybody who knows me has heard this story. I'm looking at Alexis and Shangadari in particular because they have heard this ad nauseum about when you were choreographing, and I taught it in Uganda, and they got such a kick out of it. But when you were choreographing for Return, that ballet with James Brown and Aretha Franklin music, Arthur Mitchell said to you, you gotta watch them. So in this conversation around craft, and watching for those moments that just define a move and a people. And so you told the story about Donald and doing the hip drop. And so can you say a little bit about that? Do you know what I'm talking about?
No.
Okay. Child, he done forgot the story. I've been teaching the story around the world, and he done forgot it. Okay, so what he said was, Arthur Mitchell was there and he was like, just watch how Donald Williams, watch him when you're not choreographing, when he's just listening to the music. And so Donald is standing off to the corner and some music is playing and he's going, and so he took that one, he didn't even take the two-step, he just took half the two-step. So in Return, you see a step, boom. And so what that does for me
as... And it's as, looks, actually.
But what it does for me as a lay person, I'm an audience member.
Right.
It makes me feel like they know me.
Yeah.
They know me.
I can see you.
I feel seen.
Yeah.
And it's so beautiful. Do you have a clip? Do you have a clip?
I don't have it.
Okay, all right. Well, it's on YouTube. You can see it there. But it's really, Return is the ballet that makes me feel like that's how we grew up. So it's a ballet that has a soul train line. It's a ballet that has black female empowerment. It's a ballet that just speaks to how we grew up in the 70s. It reminds me of Aunt Riri,
yeah.
Marching down
yeah.
Germantown Avenue with her bikini. Yeah. My Aunt Riri would have an orange bikini, and she was part of a drill team. So
yes.
She said, mm-hmm. In an orange bikini. Those are the people we come from. So I've also used you in terms of my work, and your influence on me can be seen in my films in terms of, and I'm thinking about Rapture and the dreaminess of the Rapture movement. And so I want to now transition to that. So we're going to take a look at Rapture. It's a short film that I did. He's in it. And it's the next evolution. I hope the sound is a little bit better on this one. But let's take a look at Rapture.
Thank you. Oh my God.
It was a Romeo and Juliet costume. She also wore it for So I Did It, It's Magic.
Oh my God. Yeah. Well, thank you. Like 30 years ago, thank you. So, you know, I guess we're about to kind of bring things full circle and wrap up soon. And so I just wanted to talk about where we are right now. Does it, because you're going to be the artistic director of the Dance Theatre of Harlem, does that mean that you will stop choreographing? What happens now?
I plan on still choreographing. I do. Virginia's mission, as guided by Arthur Mitchell, was to bring back professional performing company. And she did that. So kudos to her.
See my mom, she figures prominently in this work sample. So I think you would agree with me in the sense that we would not have the careers that we had it not been for Mom.
Oh yeah, she's definitely a big player in the idea of making us into people that are open to creativity. Mm-hmm. You know, her music thing was very good.
Yeah.
I almost consider myself more of a music person than a do a dance person in a weird way. I'm sure you have.
Oh, I totally agree with that. Yeah. It starts with the music, and you've got to be able to curate the right music in order to get the right film, the right dance, the right any of that. Mm-hmm. But absolutely, and Mom comes from a generation where she's raised by a washerwoman, her grandmother, but at the same time, you know, there's this thing around. Mom told me that, and we're talking about very humble people, and she said when they were growing up that they also needed to know another language, they also needed to know how to dance, they needed to know how to sing, how to play an instrument. There were these requirements for the most humble of us.
Yeah.
And so...
To live a fruitful life.
Well, fruitful, but also culturally relevant. Mm-hmm. And so that's how that's passed down. So I say that because I wonder if that's still happening. And so I also want to say that it's also important for the conversation as a filmmaker that we are documenting our families. Mm-hmm. You know, the fact that I don't have anything other than a song for you kind of eats me up. And we've got to, whenever the person says, can I film you, please say yes. We've got to document our families. You know, that is so very important. And so I just thought that was important to say. But without any further ado, I present the work sample for Washington.
The 5-for-15 protest stretched across the U.S. from New York to Los Angeles.
Should the federal government pay billions of dollars in reparations to African Americans who are descended from slaves as a way to make amends for the atrocity of American slavery?
I am angry at the way that the home care workers are treated.
People fighting for their economic due talks of reparations. I know the personal is political, but I didn't understand that the political is personal until I talked to you, my mother.
My grandmother would never mention the type of work that she did. Ironing, washing, hustling, you know, just to get a quarter, maybe 50 cents for the weekend. That's what we did. The memory of all that is almost gone.
To go forward in time, I need to go back in time and find others who could tell me about the full-time profession of my great-grandmother, Marie Sampson.
Never be realized.
talked about the beginning of BPH. The question is, what will you do in your role? What's your vision that builds upon the reality that formed the company? Because we're still in the same place in the 60s when he decided to form this company. We still have those same issues. So from an artistic standpoint, what's your vision to maintain that history and that purpose that Mr. Mitchell started out with the company?
Well, you know, for me, my experience with Dance Theatre of Harlem always has had the two-sided idea of both very much like W.E. Du Bois' Dutch, the African-American heritage side and the ballet side. And so those two things, bringing those two things still to the forefront is going to be part of the mission. One of the things that people, and I have to remember this as part of our story as an organization, oftentimes we were doing some of these works by choreographers, but we were often under strictures. Like oftentimes some of the Balanchine work that Mr. Balanchine gave Dancing Harlem for free was great because we learned how to do it, but we couldn't perform it in a certain radius. We couldn't perform it in New York City Ballet performing. We couldn't perform it with another white company in another city when we were in tour, right, Virginia? We always had these weird gatekeepers on our lives in that way. That's a historic fact, and so part of my thing is also bringing that to the forefront so that people can remember, again, what exactly, why this space was created. Very much like this church, you know, or the black church. You know, the black church was created because we weren't treated properly in the other, you know, because of course the conversation is now, why do we need Dance Theatre of Harlem, you know? And in my opinion, in my humble opinion, you know, I believe that it still is a safe space. A space that's always been safe for people of color, children of color, black children to come study, and young people to study, and gain a part of themselves before they move into whatever, whether it's at Dance Theatre of Harlem, which is some other company. It's always good to have that experience. Mr. Mitchell always moved to campus. You know, it wasn't always about ballet. You know, so I'm interested in that idea also. You know, when I remember him, well, I should say that when he was a young boy, his cousins owned a restaurant, Lundy's. You know what the 148th Street, yeah, Lundy's. And so when his parents would pick him up from school, he often would go to the restaurant and hide behind the bar. And he would watch the waiters and waitresses deliver the food, and when they delivered the food, they would sing arias from operas. And he wondered about that. You know, then when he became Arthur Mitchell, the New York City Ballet guy, he was often called to choreograph. What opera do you think they always called Arthur Mitchell to choreograph? I'll give you two. Thank you. You know, and it was through that experience that he discovered. He was like, okay, so they can find 60 of us for this, but they don't see them anymore. Like, what is that? And so it's out of that idea that Dance Theatre of Harlem was born. So hopefully we will continue to inspire and eventually have a black opera, to be honest. I don't think it's an outdated idea, you know, or a black symphony orchestra. So, I'm sorry. That's big stuff, but he was a big, big dreamer as well.
Thank you.
So,
and
to kind of nail down on what exactly it is. I've thought a lot about what it is in this season for me, the things that draw me, and the things that the parts of his work that I'm drawn to. And there is, for me, there is a shifting of what was foundationally Black, and we're losing that. There's a shift that's happening right now. So that, you know, when I look at Return, just the fact that, here's another story that he's given me that he probably has forgotten. The kids that he's teaching the ballet to now, he has to teach the logistics of a soul train line. Do you understand what I'm saying? There is a shift that's happening in Black culture and Black people. And if we don't pay attention to that, I don't know if it's good, I don't know if it's bad, but we should always be able to choose. And so, but I know for me, my responsibility is to capture that thing that was so fundamental to me. Even when I was an engineering student, there was a part of me that always wanted to be back with my cousins, the Garlands and the Davises, because they knew how to live life in a way, you know, through culture that was so indelibly Black. And I don't know how else to define that. You know, I wish and I'm sure there are other people in other cultures that feel that certain thing, but I know that there is this amorphous thing that you see it when you see his ballets, you see it when you hear certain types of African-American music. It's that feeling that you get when you hear that note and it makes you stand up like this, like, you got to get up because there's something that's calling your soul. And
that's
so.
The word, soul, that's the word.
Soul.
Yeah.
It's soul.
It's soul.
It's soul.
Yeah. You know, and that is why that term has been applied to us frequently as a culture, because, you know, that is indeed where a lot of the genesis of our work comes from. You know, and whether it's, it happens at many different levels. You know, and it's universal, honestly.
Yeah.
You know, one of my most wonderful moments about Return was I was choreographing it, and some of the vernacular dancing, some of the Black dancers were having some challenges with. And we looked over, and the Asian girl, Linda Singh, the Chinese girl, was hitting. We were like, wait, where did that come from? You know, where did that come from? You know, and so I believe that there is a universal aspect to this as well.
Yeah.
You know, in a positive way.
And there's also the acknowledgement that our cultural art forms have been the best ambassadors around the world.
Yeah.
So it's become a standard of sorts.
Yeah.
So that, you know, when I watch TikTok and I see Asian dancers doing hip hop, I'm like, oh my God. Oh my God. And so, not to say that this is, when I talk about Blackness, it's a form of soul. Not to say that there aren't other cultures that have that, because I know I'm married to a Danish man, and there's such a thing as Danish soul. Lord knows I've seen it. But there's something that, and I'm always trying to get to it. It's like, when the former owner of, Lois, what's the legendary jazz label? Or Verve? Is it Verve? One of those, it's either Verve, Blue Note, it may be Blue Note, but the owner was a German man, and so he used to always say, there's a documentary about it, and when he would hear music that he would do, he was like, no, it's got a swing. It's got to swing. And so I'm always trying to figure out how to swing film. How do you swing film? how do you swing dance? And so it's just that indelible thing that we reach for, and I'm sure you do it as a writer. You know, I don't know how to call that thing, but I can feel it. Yeah.
There's a question here and over here.
Yeah. I don't know. Should I go or I don't?
Well, you start with an angel. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I wanted to say that I really appreciate this conversation for a number of reasons. I think it's really important when we talk about soul and when we talk about what's happening in this generation versus our generation, because I feel like we're all in the same generation, that there's a way that we have to find our way back to that. Because when I look at social media, so many times I see young Black people who are speaking to and speaking about and attempting to educate white folks. And when we were coming up, there were all kinds of programs so that we understood that what we created was important. So we were creating for us, and there was so much by us. I'm originally from New York, and I started going to the theater and all of that through field trips. I remember where I was sitting in the audience when I saw Firebird. So when you said Virginia Johnson and Gary Deloach and like these names, I know these names because like it was important for me to know these names. And there are things that I love, like opera, but if I go to the Met, I want to see Terrence Blanchard. I don't want to see the same things that I've seen. Like, Puccini is great and what have you, but like I have an appreciation for opera because of Leontine Price. And I have a love of dance because of Virginia Johnson and because of Judy Jameson. I have a love for the theater. I mean, like, all those things come from our generation. And people, like my grandmother was also a washerwoman and a domestic. My mother didn't finish high school, so I was the first person to go to college. I was the first person to go to Broadway. I was the first person to leave the country. And even though that wasn't my mother's background, she wanted me to embrace it, to know it. Even when she didn't understand, she's like, why do you want to do that? But yeah, it's here, it's open. And we don't have those opportunities.
Well, you know, because it's just a very different time. Like, I remember being 9 years old, my mom would hear the piano, we were at our cousin's house, and she made us learn the fairy voice and sing. Rolling our eyes, the fairy voice, and sing. You know, but now I have that as part of my DNA, you know, and so sometimes it, and she wasn't looking for a fruit at the time. I think that's part of what the problem is now. With young people, they're looking for the satisfaction of the moment and not for their grandkids and their great grandkids. You know, and I think that that's a really important part of that conversation as well. And the other part is benefiting from what we produce. You know, like at Lincoln Center the other day, They're selling tickets, going to Lincoln Center site, for orchestral Biddy. They orchestrate Biddy, and the tickets are expensive. And everybody's running, and it's their way of getting us there. But the reality is, I know Biddy, you know Biddy. You know, but, like, really, what is that really about? You know, I'm sorry. There's one question over here.
Washerwoman is like the Achilles heel. And then Robert, you mentioned the Jimmy Johnson movie. I think I gave the name wrong. It's harder than it looks. It's harder to learn than it looks. Mm-hmm. And then, Lana, you also mentioned in terms of, like, there were expectations when you were growing up to be able to, you know, sing and entertain. If you had guests come over, I grew up like that too, that if there were guests who came over, it's like, oh, Angel, and everybody could gather around and sing the song, you don't have to be a star to be in my show. And that was our thing. And so when I think about the comments about the Asian people who love hip hop and are actually practicing hip hop, which is a really important thing to do with anything that you are great at, is that practice. Because you learn all the little things that make you great at that thing. And I was wondering if you felt, Lana in particular, but this question is for both of you, I wonder if, especially because you talked about this film, you're still like trying to make it work. If that is part of the practice that, you know, comes about as you age, discovering like what was a foundation all along, that you've been building this foundation, because aging is absolutely a beautiful process. But what we're battling is like the other stuff. We're battling all the stories that we've been told, like they told you weren't good enough. So I wonder if you see, as these women keep talking to you, and these moves, when you're teaching kids how to form a soul train line, I wonder, do you experience any kind of revelations around the things that are unseen and the things that are unspoken? With regard to where you're supposed to be.
Absolutely.
Every day, higher and higher.
Absolutely. So, as many of you know, I turned 60 this year. And so, you know, that engendered a lot of thought as to who I am and where I am. And so, the one thing I know to be true is that in this walk that I call life, one of the things that I probably would have done more, and this is for my young dancers, is the in-moment vulnerability. Being in the moment and being vulnerable enough and open and authentic enough to yourself to be able to get to that thing that you always want to get to. So, as a young, I started my career at HBO as a producer, and it's in the system of capitalism, it's about commodification, and I'm always plugging through, trying to get the things done, trying to get the thing out, trying to meet the deadline. And so there becomes a way of being around that. But when you're creating art, two things, and this is what I've learned from the School of Documentary in particular, you have to be on the journey. You, as the documentarian, you have to go on a journey. So you don't know what's going to come out on that other end. And that is, I'm sorry, does this thing bother you? I'm seeing it reflect. Is it getting on your nerves?
No.
Go ahead. It's okay. Reflect. But it's spirit. It's spirit. So it's very much like that. It's very much like that. So I'm trying to catch up to spirit. So it took me a while to really put that thing down that said this is what the story is going to be about. And I have to be vulnerable enough to stand before you and say, I'm getting older and I'm afraid. Sometimes I'm afraid. And I know that there's this profession and there are these women that are expecting me. I hear them and they're saying to me, tell the story, baby. Tell the story, baby. Take your time and tell the story. Because you know what? There's nothing better than being around elder or an older woman who's in the Jedi season. So in order for me to be a Jedi, I gotta give it up. And just, it's like a channeling, and it's a constant channeling. And so at this point, you know, I do that through my art, and I do my art also through other people. You can't do film without having other people. So there are people that I reach out to, and I'm like, I need to do this with you because I can't do it by myself. And those other people hold my feet to the fire, and we go through this process together. So what I've learned is the art and the act of vulnerability and authenticity.
Real quick, unfortunately, we gotta wrap this up. I know it's been a great, great evening. Y'all show your love for Lana. But before we wrap up, I'm gonna ask a question, if that's all right. We have one more question. One more question, and then we'll get to the last question.
With the next generation, because our dancer danced to Nina Simone's Namakite Pop. Yeah. She could have danced to anything, and that's what she chose this evening. So as an educator, Lana, I know you are, I know your brother is as well, and an educator that's both intelligent, we're using both sides of our brains, right? And so we have an opportunity with this next generation to bring them in. So I love what you said about the Jedi, because I think that as we get older, we realize there's power in that, but there's also purpose in it. Mm-hmm. And you can share and extend that purpose. We can create community by not seeing ourselves as oppositional generations.
That's right.
But as opportunities. And so I think what you did this evening was absolutely beautiful.
Absolutely.
It was a choice. That's a choice, and so I thank you for that. But I also thank you all both for not only to see I'm the middle child with an older brother, and to see this conversation was really beautiful, and it was vulnerable, and your film made me cry. So thank you, Lana, for sharing. I'm glad I got to ask the final question, but yeah, it's more of a comment than a question. That I do think we have an opportunity with the next generation, with dance and with film and theater and all of these things that, can bring them in to what we were brought into every Saturday morning while we cleaned our house.
Thank you.
I was just going to say that's awesome.
Okay, I just wanted to say really briefly that yes, it can be a challenge for our generation to kind of manage that conversation with our younger folks. And so, but the thing that is really important to me is that there's this concept in jazz called circular breathing. And when you see that, it's quite remarkable. And so I think of it very much like circular breathing. So it's like at one point, in one instance, I'm inhaling, so I'm taking the things that generation is giving me. They're giving me a conversation about non-binary folks that I never had before. They're bringing a lexicon into being that is so very necessary and expands my humanity. So as I'm taking that in, we also have to breathe that back out. They may be saying, it's time for you to sit down, honey. We don't need you anymore, but you don't listen to that, right? You don't have to listen to that, because once you start exhaling and giving what they need, they recognize it. And then when they see that you're also taking in, the bits that they're sharing, the conversation becomes circular. And so we're able to do that dance that we need to do to kind of move forward. So thank you for that, Dawn.
You know, I was just going to say that song reminds me of the story that Arthur Mitchell told me. George Balanchine, Arthur Mitchell's mentor, founded the University of Dallas, was in Paris, yes. And he had a dalliance with Josephine Baker, and it was behind that song. She sang that song, and after that, he was like, okay. So that's my favorite.
Okay, so we do have one more for my dancer, Miss Jay.
Hello. So I wanted to piggyback on what you said. I do feel like from a younger generation, there is a disconnect.
Can you speak up?
Oh, as a person from the younger generation, I do feel like there is a disconnect with the older generation. And I feel like we can be educated more on our own Black history, because I remember like 2 years ago, I was talking to somebody about the Black Panther Party. They didn't know what I was talking about. Like, we about the same age. You don't know about that? Like, even though I'm young, I was like disheartened by that. But I'm like, you should know what your people go through. You should know the trials and tribulations that we've been through. And I just feel like some people in my generation, they feel like the older generation is stuck in their ways and ignorant, and I feel like to a certain extent, the older generation feels like we're ignorant too. But I feel like we do need to have more conversations like this, because it's needed. And I feel like I just really, I would like to talk to older people, because I have really old.
One of the things that technology has created is a peer-to-peer structure for advice and everything else, peer-to-peer, so that a lot of your generation are looking at your peers for information.
We don't know nothing.
Exactly. I know, and the reason for that is because technology is outpacing our morals and our ethics. If our morals and our ethics were growing as fast as our technology, then we'd be in a different situation. So not only do we have to figure out how to get to you, but we also have to figure out how to get to you and grow in that other area, that business. Which I would like.
It's not really a question, it was just like a bit of advice. Like, as a young Black kid, I've always felt like an outcast as a dancer. I feel like people who don't dance, or like don't appreciate dance, like they've never understood me. Like, it's hard for people to connect with people outside of dance, but
like for most part,
you connected with this man right here and performed on a stage at Hayti. You did that.
And the people
need
find you.
Yeah, go for your
try. I have one last. I know we can talk all night, but I have this quick question. As they would say, a seasoned artist. you know, a lot of times. As artists, already hard being an artist of color. Do you feel like this is a two-part question. Do you feel like you've made it in your career? And if you have, why and why not? And two, people don't know how many hours we put into this, but aren't you tired? And if you are, how do you practice self-care?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so I'm talking bullet points because I know we're short on time. Am I tired? Yeah. I'm real tired. I'm tired. There's tired on my tired. I'm tired. And so at this point, you know, one of the reasons why I'm transitioning out of the role of director of the film festival is because I'm tired, but thank goodness we've got the capable hands of Tyra Dixon, who's going to take it to the next level. So thank you, Tyra. Next, directed. And so I'm at the point now where I'm trying not to produce anymore, and I'm only wanting to direct. And I'm not taking on other people's projects anymore. It's only my project.
If you don't know, there's layman terms for other people's projects and your problems. Barbara, how about you?
Are you tired? You know, I really, really get so much joy from the space that I'm in. I get joy from my spiritual life, which is actually that church in New York. You know, traveling bus past, you know, and my space where I work. You know, our future created a very private space for me to thrive. And I love him for that. And so my being tired would be sort of in the front of my mind today. You know, he's giving me independence, which I have to deal with anyone, you know, even at all. You know, and so that's a beautiful thing. Yeah, it's a blessing.
Well, I want to show end with the clips that I represent from Dance Theatre of Harlem. Like two clips, I think it's called Real or
There's one from Return.
Return, that's it. So I want to end with that, if that's okay with everybody. And you know, we can finish the conversation outside if you guys would like. But y'all give a round of applause for Robert and Lana. So we're going to show this last clip, and actually you have a buy one, get one free offer from Carolina Theater, and I think the password is ballet, I believe, so y'all can get that as well. So we're going to show this last clip, and we're going to be out here. So thank y'all very much. Thank you all so much for coming out. And last but not least, we have Black and Brown Ballet here, dance class every Tuesday night. So y'all make sure y'all come through and stop by Leah Baker. So y'all make sure y'all come out and check that out every Tuesday at 6:30 to 8 p.m. So come get in ballet class. It's for all ages, all right? So thank y'all, and y'all have a great night.
Period.